Yeah. tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know. No, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your place to hide, and I am not a captive to lie. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. Oh, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. My that's how I fight my battle.
Come on, sing it out. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. Come on, sing it out, sing it out, sing it out, church. This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I
fight my battles. Come on.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I. This is how I.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles. Come on, it may look like.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
This is how we fight our battles.
This is how we fight our battles.
This is how we fight our battles.
This is how I fight my battles.
'Cause this is how we fight our battles.
This is how I fight.
'Cause this is how I fight my battles.
This is how I fight.
'Cause this is how we fight our battles. Worship and praise. This is how I fight my battles. 'Cause this is how I fight battles. This is how I fight my battles. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I'm
precious.
regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling.
Lord bless you. gracious to you, Lord, send His face towards you and give you peace.
Come on, sing it out, church.
And Lord bless you and keep you. May His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn His face towards you. Generations and your family and your children and their children and their children, and His favor be upon you and 1,000 generations on your family and your children and their children and their children. May His favor be upon you and 1,000 generations, in your family, in your children, in their children, in their children. May His favor be upon you and 1,000 generations, in their family, in their children, in their children, in their children. Make His presence go before you and behind you and beside you. All around you, deep within you, He is with you,
He is with you.
In the morning, in the evening, when you're coming, and you're going, and you're weeping, and rejoicing, He is for you, He is for you.
generations are going to be impacted for the love of God, for what you're doing right now here. I can tell you, God is going to do great things in your life. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning. Thank you, Father. Amen. Good morning. Good morning for you that are watching us in the Facebook Live. Good morning for all of you that are present here in the building. We want to take a time for to honor God with our offerings, but before I want to announce something very important, maybe the team there that is managing the live stream can put the information about the Life Academy. Life Academy is a school that wants to equip, wants to build, develop leaders with the fear of God, so you guys can impact in the nations, and not just Belize, but in all the nations. And I want to tell you that God is doing great things in Life Church. And we have here a lot of miracles in many areas. And we want you to be part of this movement of miracles. We want to tell you that registration process is open. We have take a lot of information from the persons, from the people who is interesting to join the school. The school, the first school that we are opening is discipleship. And we want each of you that are watching us and the ones who are here wants to join the discipleship training. Please get in contact to us through the Facebook Live, or you can text me directly to my WhatsApp or my Facebook so we can start the process. We are projecting to start school on the 29th of November. So you still have time. You still have time. We want you to be part of this. And for those who still may be doubting if that's for you, please get in contact so you can get more information, so you can have more clarity about what it is, because we want you to be part of it. And I want to share this morning, there are two reasons why. There are two different things between living in victories and living just in bad times. You know, we have spoke a lot about the seasons that we experience in our lives. And one of the differential things between a season and a lifestyle is the word believe. That you can make your trial and your problems become a lifestyle and become part of your life for the rest of your life if you don't believe. And the reason why this word is very, very important is because God and Jesus Christ make it very clear in the Bible for you, like essential for you to live well. And listen this, Matthew 21 verse 22. It says, and whatever you ask in prayer, you will receive it if you have faith. So the question here is, are we asking, and if we have faith, we will receive. Mark 9:23 says, and Jesus said to him, if you can, all things are possible for who believes. And John chapter 1, 12 says, but to all who did receive him, who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. So the ones who believe in his name. Therefore, Mark 11 says, I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe it, that you will receive it, and it will be yours. John 20, 29 says, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. So it is essential for you to capture that it is by believing. And you can tell your situation, and you can tell your problems, and you can tell your financial hardships, I will believe. I'll prefer believe that this is just going to be a season in my time, in my life. And I will have the conviction that this is going to pass. Because God says, if I believe, he will do it for me. And that's the conviction that we have. And I want to tell you this morning that believe is something that is hard, and we know, because I've been there many times. I've been there where you have to go through difficult times, very hard problems, you know, that you have not even a little bit of faith just to believe, because for you it's impossible to go out of that situation. And I want you to believe this morning. I want you to start increasing your faith and ask people to pray for you and get in contact with people who have the gift of faith. Because many, you know, the Bible says that each of us have received a portion of faith. But some of us have developed that faith more than others. And if you know somebody who has the gift of faith, please talk to that person so you can get encouraged and you can develop your faith. And you know what? Challenge your faith. Start challenging your faith. Make exercise. Like, for example, you ask God, God, I will not do this, and I will expect this. And you start having a relationship with God through faith. Because you can tell God, God, I will make this decision, but I will need a miracle for you to stop it. And I will, and try to not tread God or manipulate the faith, but start practicing faith by believing that God is with you. And when God is with you, you can start practicing the faith like that. So, Father, we pray, Lord, that every single person that is watching us and that is here this morning, Lord, that you will fulfill them, Father, with the faith so they can start believing, Lord, in things that looked impossible to become possible. Father, we believe in miracles, that for those who are challenging, Father, with a lot of finance problems, Lord, we believe that you're going to make miracles and that you're going to create great things, Lord, in them. Father, I pray that you will organize our finance, that you will create a miracle, Father, that you will bring revival, Father, in our families. And we're going to see revival in every single area of our lives. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Good morning, yeah. Okay, I am here already. That sounds kind of weird. This is a good morning. I am so happy to be back here again. And the worship was so amazing. I wish that all of you could have been here. And all those that are watching, I wish you could have been here. But I know that the time is coming soon. And so this morning, as I start, I want to thank you for allowing us to come into your homes. Right now, before you do anything else, I would ask you please to share the message with your friends or just share it on your Facebook page, because I believe that this message has the power to radically change, transform your life, and especially your marriage. You might say, oh, I'm not married yet. But this can prepare you to be married one day. And all you that are married, I want you to let your married friends know to watch. Because this can change your life. And I know that being married for some years now, most married people try to hide when they have problems, right? Most marriages try to act like everything's okay, everything is hunky-dory until everything falls apart and it's unrepairable, right? And so this morning, before I start, I want to let you know that my message this morning is not something that I read somewhere. I have a good storybook that was written some years ago by some big pastor. This message today is on my own life story. And so I'm saying it to let you know that if you are in a situation right now where if you think there's no way out, you think that there's hope has lost, that I want to let you know that that's not so, that there is hope for you. And so if you have any friends that need to get their marriage back in order and learn something to revive their marriage, please let them know to watch this message. Share it with them. And so
I want you to also leave comments. And if you are right now, if you're watching right now and you're married and you have a perfect marriage, I want you to comment below and say amen, because I want to contact you after the service and get some information, right? So if you have a perfect marriage, please comment below. And all the rest of us, we're going to admit that there can be, it can be better, right? And so if you are one of the marriages that say that, you know what, we could make some changes. We could actually do something to our marriage that would make it better. Then I want you to put a thumbs up there. Not amen, because then I think you're perfect, right? Put a thumbs up down below. If you think that your marriage could grow, your marriage could make some changes to make better, then put a thumbs up, and you're going to learn something this morning. We believe that, not we believe, we know that revival is here. We know that the revival has come to the city of Belize. And we know that God is moving. We just had a prophetic confirmation this week that revival is indeed here at Life Church. And so before I go on, I just want to pray. Father, I thank you for allowing us to come together again. Father, we know that this is your time, that you want to move in this nation and this city. And Lord, I thank you for 2020. I thank you for the revival that is happening in Belize City, in our lives, in our marriages, in our church, in our businesses, in our finances, Lord, in our relationships, in our bodies, in our health, Father God. We thank you. Lord, we thank you that 2020 is going to be, has been, and is going to be an amazing year of transformation. Lord, we know, and you know as well, Father, that this COVID-19 has done a number on us. And we pray, Father God, that you would just wipe it away, Father God. Just, Lord, that this COVID-19 would just pass over, Father God, so we can come together again, Lord. We can fellowship again. We can be together as one family, Lord Jesus. That's our heart's desire. And we thank you, Lord, and we ask you for that in the name of Jesus. And I pray this morning that you would touch hearts. And Lord, I pray that we would be vulnerable this morning. I pray that every single person that is watching right now, all those married people, that they would be vulnerable this morning and honest with themselves so they can receive something, Lord, that would bless their hearts and that would radically transform their lives. In the name of Jesus, amen. It is back hot again, so we are drinking water. Correcto. Anyway, revival is here. The question is, are you a part of it? And the question is, are you willing to do what it takes to see and be a part of the movement of God in the city and the nation of Belize? Revival is a result of someone or a group of people being serious about the state of our souls and lives, and pray and shift the atmosphere and partner with God to bring revival. Revival does not happen by just one day somebody wakes up and revival happens when there's a group of people or a person that is tired of the state of the place, that is tired of the state of the believers and of this country where he is, and prays and intercedes and sacrifices until God moves. And so my question to you this morning is, are you a part of it? Or are you just watching from on the sidelines? Our heart's desire is to see revival bring transformation in every area of our lives, every sector of society, every business, every household, every street, every government office. And that we would live a life that pleases God. And revival in marriage is one of the places where revival needs to take place for transformation to take place We can have revival. Everybody can be jumping around and praising God. But if revival does not transform the marriages, we're going to go back to the same place we were before, because it is in the marriage that all this starts. If the marriage is messed up, if the marriage is all in a shambles, we cannot expect that revival to take place in anywhere else. Marriage is God's idea. And it brings out and glorifies God when it's alive and well. The enemy knows that marriages are a sacred institution. Marriage is a symbol, and it's in heaven, and it's a God idea. When the marriage is dead and broken, it causes so many hurt children and relationships. And all you that are not married, you say, "Oh, so what's the big deal about, you know, like, I'm not married yet." Yes, just open your hearts and learn. Because one day you want to be a mom. One day you want to be a father. And I can advise you, and I can tell you from experience, that my marriage, my wife, my kids would have suffered much less if I had had the information, if I had been informed how to be a father, how to be a husband, from before I got married, it would have been better. So I'm telling you, those that are single right now, learn whatever you can and all that you can, because the day you get married, you will need every information, all information, every idea that exists under the sun will help you to have a better and a more successful marriage. So as you're listening, if you're single, don't turn this off. Don't turn that dial. Just keep on. Share with your friends. Let everybody know. Keep on putting comments down below. Because right now it's going to get a little better as we speak. When your marriage is dead and it's broken, like I said, it causes so many pain. You might say, "Oh, that's a marriage." Listen. Healthy kids. Or let me put it this way. The percentage of kids or the success rate or the chance of being successful in life is so much higher when you grew up in a functional, godly marriage. Like if your parents are married and live a godly life, your chance in life of being successful is so much greater. Why? Because you grew up in a functional place where kids can be protected and grow in that family environment. A strong marriage makes a strong family. A strong family makes a strong church. A strong church makes what? Strong community. So when you see a broken community, when you see gangsters walking around that looks like they're dragging around their life, you see people shooting each other, beating each other, cursing each other, moms and dads all over the place, drunk and all kind of thing. That is results of a broken marriage. And that is why all these government institutions that are saying we're going to change down south side of the city. We're going to just, all the good stuff. You know what? Alert. It won't happen. The government institutions cannot change the problem. Why? Because it's a marriage problem. All those gangsters and criminals, they come from broken families. They come from broken marriages. And if we want to see transformation in the city, if we want to see the homes come together the way Christ wants them to, if we want them to represent the kingdom of God, it starts at the marriage. It starts at husband and wife, mother and father. That's where it starts. And that is why I am so passionate about talking about marriage. Because if we have a strong marriage, we have a strong family. When we have a strong family, we have a strong community. A strong church first, and then when you have a strong church, we have a strong community. And you know what a strong community does? It creates a strong and healthy and prosperous country. And I believe everybody that's watching, I pray that everybody that's watching right now, they have a heart's desire to live in a country that's prosperous, healthy, and free. And to see that happening, we got to work on the marriages. The marriage has to come together. We need revival in our marriages to see that happening. If we cannot have revival in our marriages, we cannot see revival that's going to transform this city. Marriage is one of the places it has to happen for that to take place. So my question to you is, all you that are here and all of them that are watching right now, if marriage is the beginning of transformation, if a strong country is dependent on strong marriages, what do you think the enemy will attack most? Marriages. He will attack marriages. Why? Because if he can get your marriage into shambles, if he can screw up your marriage, he has screwed up the country, and he knows it so well, and that's where he starts. He always starts there. And so that's why we need leaders in every sector of society who honor the marriage, who honor the marriage bed. What do we mean with that? We need leaders in this country that do not have side chicks or sweethearts on the side. Because that right there breaks the family apart. And don't talk to me about having a strong marriage. I know that it's a Belizean weakness. But look around us. Look around us. What's the problem? That is the problem right there. That's where it starts. When every husband, every man has 3-4 women, that is the result. The results of that is the criminals on the street, the poverty, all the broken up families, all the messed up kids in the street. They don't even know where their fathers are. They don't even know how to act like a man. That's the result that comes from a broken marriage, a relationship that is not honoring God. And so the enemy will attack that. And you know me personal, I know of so many marriages that have fallen apart. I know of marriages that have fallen apart that are God-fearing. They're going to church, and their marriages went to shambles, fell apart. And what's the problem? How in the world can that happen? How in the world can Christian couples fall apart? You might ask, were they really Christians? Did they really serve God? Can that really happen? And I'm here to tell you, yes, it can. You can be seriously and madly in love with God, and your marriage can go to shambles. You might ask, why or how is that possible? Well, look around you, and I can guarantee you that if you have family and friends in the city, that you know somebody whose marriage fell apart not very long ago. And you might say they go to church, they pray, they believe in God. And how can that happen? And it really, really saddens my heart. Because in most cases, the enemy was able to make the couples their own enemies. So they fought with each other instead of for each other against the enemy who has come to kill, to steal, and destroy. And this is one thing, all you that are married and all you that are learning that want to be married one day. If you want to have one of the keys to have a successful, strong marriage, always remember, you are not fighting against your partner. You're always fighting for your partner. And you need to know that when you have arguments, when you have disagreements, that you are not fighting against your partner. You're fighting against the enemy who comes to kill, to steal, and destroy. And when you remember that, you are going to be more careful not to destroy your partner. Because many times, we believe that our partner is the enemy when it's not. The enemy is the devil himself. And we need to fight the enemy together with our partner. And that's how you're going to overcome it. And this is why we need revival in the marriage in this country. We need couples to turn back to their first love. We need revival to burn away all the hatred and animosity that is around in our marriages. And you know, I have Facebook, as all of you probably have. And I see people post things. And I must say that it really saddens my heart many times. I will talk to you, woman, right now a little bit, and please don't shoot me, okay? Please. And if you want to leave all kind of comments below, that's okay. If you're hurt, but I want to talk to you, woman, right now. Ladies, all the comments that you put on Facebook, I'm not saying everyone is, but many are. You are destroying the creation that God has made. I see so many comments. Oh, I don't need a man. Oh, I'm the father to this child and the mother. You know what those things do? The exact opposite of what you do. When your son sees that message, what do you think it does to your son? When your son sees a message that my mom says that I don't need a man in my life, I don't need a husband in my life, I am the father for this child, you know what it does to your son? It crushes his spirit. And the Bible says that for a person who crushes the spirit of a child, it will be better to tie a rock and the neck and throw it in the deepest of the sea for that person to die and go away. Because when you crush the spirit of your kid, you're destroying his life and his future. And I'm telling you, ladies, please stop it. Please do never, never again say that I don't need a man in my life. I don't need a husband. I don't need a father for my kid. You are destroying the same people that you love. You're destroying the same people that are going to change this country. You're destroying the same people that you see that are your heart and you live for only. I see so many ladies said, my kid is, how do you say it? That's all my life. Or all my, you know, stop it. You are destroying the same people you love. We can't do that. We need to stop it. We need to go back to the basics. We need to go back to the Word of God and see what God says. Because we need revival. We need these marriages to work. Because we want to see a change in this country. So we need the marriages to work. This country needs strong marriages to rise and transform the families and family life. My question to you all who are married. Here's a question for you. Where are you? Where are you in your marriage? Ask yourself. Don't look at nobody else. Don't think about all these people you know that their marriage is going to hell in a handbasket. Don't worry about them. You, I'm asking you, where is your marriage? Ask yourself, where is your marriage? Where are you when it comes to being the husband? Where are you when it comes to you being the father? Or where are you when it comes to being the wife and the mother for your kids? Is your marriage on fire? Or is it dead and distant? And needs God to move and bring revival. God wants to send revival into every marriage and every family. But the question is, are you ready for change? The question is, are you at the end of the rope? Are you at the end where you know that you cannot do it no more, you cannot hide it no more, and you can't change it no more? Or do you think you can handle it? No worry, I'm going to handle it one day, it's going to change. I am confident that in most marriages, if I would ask the wife by herself, I would take her by the side, and I would ask her, well, let me put it this way. If I would ask the husband and wife together, how's your marriage? In 90% of the cases, I won't say how many, but in most cases, the husband would quickly jump and say, our marriage is pretty good. We're doing better. It's getting better. But if I would take that same wife of that husband to the side, and I would ask her personal, in your eyes, in your heart, in your mind, how do you rate your marriage? I can guarantee you that in many cases, the wife would say, our marriage is dead, that we're distant, our marriage is into the drain, we're messed up, we need help. You see, we husbands are so strong built that we think that we can handle everything on our own. And so this morning I'm asking you, where is your marriage? Be honest with yourself. And here's the good news. I want you to know. My question to you, I want you to be honest and very serious about this. But at the same time, I am not here to condemn you. I'm here to help you. So I want you to know that being at the end of your rope, having a messed up marriage, is not the end of life, is not the end of everything, because we can fix it. You can fix it. God wants a revival in your marriage. God wants to revive your marriage. God wants to bring fire back between you two. But my question is, are you ready to allow God to do that? Or are you still at the place where you think, oh, no, everything's okay. Everything's hunky-dory. I'm going to be able to fix it one day somehow, somewhere, right? And I'm telling you, if you'd ask your wife, she might say different. And we men are usually very insensitive and don't have the emotional connections with our wives that we truly know the status of our relationship. Me and my wife the other day did a Bible plan together. And that Bible plan was for marriages. And the question was, how do you rate your marriage? Me as being this godly husband, I put there 7. And my ungodly wife said 3. I'm sorry. That just proves to you that we husbands can be very insensitive to the needs of our wives. And I believe that God wants to revive our marriages. God wants us to go back to the first love. And all you that are singing or listening to me, please listen carefully, because you can learn a lot this morning, so that when you get married, you can start off on the right track. You don't have to live many years married until you find out and figure it out by yourself, like we did. I did myself. I grew up in a community where they didn't teach you about marriage. I was not taught anything about marriage when I grew up. Not a single thing. Everything I know, I had to learn and get it myself. And many times, if you have not been taught, you first make a million mistakes until you realize that you are up the shit's creek and you need to find help. And I'm telling you this morning that if you're not married, learn. Learn from my experience. Learn from my pain so you don't have to go through that. You might say, oh, you know what? You're talking all this because you have a great marriage. Oh, you have a good marriage. Everything is hunky-dory. No, I'm speaking about my own. I am speaking from my heart. I'm speaking from my personal journey. The enemy is laughing at the thoughts of you that you think, I'm just making up a story. This is my journey. We've had a very rocky and very rough marriage. And if you would ask my wife, she would tell you, if she wants to be honest, I think she would, that she gave up many times on me in her marriage. She gave up many times and didn't think that it would ever change. That we lived together in the same house, growing, training up kids, having a family, but not be close together as a couple. And you might say, oh, that must be many, many years ago. No, that's not when we were pastors. We were pastors. We were helping others and counseling marriages while we were in deep, deep, deep mess. And why am I sharing this? Because I want you to know that we can be God-fearing. We can go to church. We can preach. And our marriage can be going to hell in a handbasket. Why? You may say, how in the world is that possible? Like I said, I know so many people. I know so many couples in the last year that their marriage has fallen apart in the midst of going to church. And I knew a couple problems. And I'm going to share the ones that I was struggling with, why our marriage was in a problem. And this is the one. Here's one of the problems. I was not able to emotionally connect because I grew up with all the emotions. And then on top of that, I had made ministry and work more important than my wife and kids. All you men out there, I know that making money and providing for your family is so important. That so drives our manhood. We need that for our self-esteem. But it's so easy for us to take that ahead of our wife and our kids. And that was my mistake. Because I'm a driver, I'm a visionary, that when I see something, I want to get it done, I want to get it done now. And that caused our marriage to fall apart. And because I was never I did not grow up being emotional healthy. I didn't have any emotions. I did not emotionally connect with my wife. So I did not feel what she was feeling. I was not able to identify or notice that or her emotions were not being met and that we were not connected emotionally. And so for many years, we were pastors, but our marriage was in deep, deep, deep mess. And it's like a crazy cycle. And when things go a little rough, the more you want to work, the more we want to go to church, right? To just get over it. And here is the hard thing. Here is the hard reality. I emotionally lost my family. I was broken into pieces when I found out the truth and the reality of it all. It took many years. It took many years for me to finally face the truth. I had no other way out of it or no idea how to make it work. I cried for many nights and begged God for another chance. Because my wife told me that I love you, but I have no connection with you. I love you, but there's no connection that I have with you. And when I realized that my kids, that I had no emotional connection with them, I had no emotional support for them, that I had lost every single connection as a father to their kids, I was broken into pieces. And like I said, I cried many nights and I begged God, please give me a chance. Help me. Teach me how to make a connection with my kids again. When your daughter walks away from your life and says that your dad does not protect me or my emotions, that cuts deep to the heart. And when your wife tells you that we are just together in one house raising a family, that is a deep pain that it causes. But it was reality. And it hurt. And it hurt like hell. And it makes you feel so condemned and worthless. And you feel like you have nothing left. You have failed so bad that you don't even want to show your face to people that have any clue or idea where you're going and what has happened. But here's the good news, everybody that's watching. Here's the good news, that God never gives up on you. God will never give up on you. And God will give you a chance again and again and again. The only problem is sometimes your wife does not give you a chance. Sometimes they are done. But God is always giving you a chance. I cried out to God. And God has blessed me with revival in our family and our marriage. I can tell you that it has not been easy. Nor are we where I would like us to be. But I can tell you that we have come far. We have come far as a marriage, as a couple, and as a family. And revival is happening. I'm being able to connect with my so your prayers will not be hindered. Peter is saying, if you want your prayers to be answered, you need to treat your wife with honor. Yes, she might be weaker, but she is equal in the presence of God. In the kingdom of God, she's equal, but she is your helpmeet. And honor her. If you want your prayers answered, you need to honor your wife. You need to honor your wife. And wives, I'm not letting you go right now. Let me read the next one. Ephesians 5:22-29. It says, wives, submit to your husbands, to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of your church, his body of which he is the Savior. So wives, submit to your husbands. Respect your husbands. Do not try to be their mothers. Your husband did not marry you to have another mother. He has one, and that's all he needs. He does not need a mother again. Don't be his mother. Be his wife. Submit to him. Respect him. If you respect your husband, I guarantee you he's going to love you. Any wife that tells me that my husband does not love me, I'm going to ask them, do you respect him? If you do not respect your husband, it's going to be hard for your husband to love you. So wives, respect your husband, submit. You're not a doormat. No. But God put an order. And when you do the right thing the right way, God blesses the marriage. God blesses the union. And God blesses your family. And verse 24 says, now as the church submits to the Christ, also so wives submit to their husbands in everything. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, guys, it's your turn. You can say ouch if you want to. Bend over and he's going to give you a little slapping. Now it says, verse 25. Ephesians 5, verse 25 says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. How much was that? The Bible says, love your wife until you're dead. Love until you die. I don't know how much that is because I'm still alive, right? But husbands, love your wife as Christ loved the church and give up himself for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with the water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holiness and blame. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as your own bodies. And I'm telling you, most people that are sane in their heads, they love their own bodies. Some look in the mirror too much. If your mirror is killing you, throw away your mirror. But husbands, love your wife as yourself. It says, he who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one hates their body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does for the church. So my closing words, guys and gals, husband and wives, if you're watching this message, now live or later, and you're up to the end of the rope, and wives, I know your husbands, they don't want to agree immediately. They don't want to admit it. But if you're watching, woman, and your marriage, you say your marriage is up the creek and you need somebody to help you, you want a revival back in your marriage, please contact us. Please, we can help you with whatever we know. And we know what God has done for our marriage. We know what God has done for our family. And that is the heart's desire that we have. We want to see every marriage, every family, healthy and alive. And so if you're watching, and man, if you're watching, please just give in and just make it better, right? And so please contact us. If you just contact the church, and they can direct that to us if you do, we want to help you. We want to walk with you. And we want revival to come to your marriage. We want revival to come to your homes. Because I can tell you the truth. Life is not worth living half dead. And revival in your marriage, revival in your home, makes life worth living. That makes life worth living every second of the day. And that is a heart desire that we have. We want to see you walk and live healthy and happy and whole. So this morning, please don't be shy. Please don't suffer for another day in silence. And let us know. We want to help you walk in victory. And we want to help you walk in a marriage and live a happy and healthy life. And before I close, I just want to say again, the discipleship training that we're going to start. Please, if you want to learn how to walk in victory, you want to learn how to become a successful follower of Jesus Christ, please register with us, and you will learn a lot. It's going to be like a 9-month process, this whole program. But at the end, we're going to have a graduation. We're going to make it as professional as we can, as worthwhile as we can. And I'm telling you that you do not want to miss it. So contact Odun, Serrano, or contact the church and get yourself connected, registered, so you can learn and be discipled to become a discipler as well. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for all those that are watching this morning. I thank you for all those that are going to listen to this message, Lord. I pray for the marriages right now. And I pray for revival to come in the hearts of the man and woman. I pray for revival in their marriages, Lord Jesus. I pray for the men to humble themselves and turn from their ways and seek you, Jesus, and find help for their marriages, Lord. I pray for unity in the marriage, Lord. I pray for fire to rise up and the marriage to be strong and healthy and whole. And I thank you for your plan and purpose. I thank you that you have an amazing plan, amazing thoughts, an amazing will for all the marriages, Lord. I pray for everyone watching right now in the name of Jesus, that you touch their hearts, guide them, Holy Spirit, help them to become all that you created them to be, Lord Jesus. And if there's somebody watching right now that has never made the Lord of Jesus the Lord of your life, and you say, you know what? I really need that. I want to clean up my life. I want to make it right with Jesus. And you say, you know what? I don't know where I'm gonna go if I die, and you want to be sure. I want you to repeat after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. I ask you to forgive me, cleanse me, and heal me. I make you my Lord and Savior. And I thank you for dying on the cross so I can be saved. In the name of Jesus, amen. If you pray that prayer with sincerity, I believe you're born again. Get in contact with us. Let us know. Let us help you walk the walk of faith. And I must say, God bless you guys. Have a wonderful Sunday. Please send this message to your friends, because we want to see marriages strong, healthy, and whole. Jesus died so you can live and live well. Amen, and God bless.